Okay, now much later, when the first instruction gets issued from the issue queue, it completes, produces a result in P33, and tells the reorder buffer that I have now finished. So at this point, the reorder buffer is going to commit instruction number one. Okay, so at this point, I'm going to make this instruction permanent. And so it had previously stored a result in P33. Okay, so now P33 becomes the permanent value of R1. Okay, so the permanent value of R1 used to be in P1. That has now been changed to P33. At this point, I'm never going to look at the value in P1. Right? If I ever need the value in R1, I will look at the value in P33. So this register P1 has no use anymore. So this can now be released. This can now be put back into the free pool or into the rename pool. So P1 joins this list over here. Okay, next, instruction 2 is going to commit. And that second instruction is going to make the contents of P34 permanent, right? So this instruction produced a result in P34. So the latest value of R2 or the latest committed value of R2 can be found in P34, not in P2. And so P2 joins this free pool over here. Then the third instruction commits, and since it never used a rename register, it has to do nothing upon commit, right? It just commits and says, I'm now done. And since the branch was predicted correctly, I'm not going to squash any instructions and so on. So this one's done too. Then instruction 4 commits, and it says that the value in P3 is no longer required, so that can be placed in the free pool. And the value P35 is the permanent home of R3 now. Okay, and then R1 comes along, this instruction comes along and commits instruction 5. And at this point, I say that, you know, now if I ever care about the value in R1, it is the value in P36, not the value in P33. So now P33 gets put back in the free pool again. Okay, and so on. Okay, so a key point over here is that, you know, instructions get placed in the free pool only when one instruction commits. Because it is only at the time of commit that you realize that some old register value will no longer be used, and you will always refer to this to some new value. Okay, let me just explain this a little bit more with, say, register R3 over here. Okay, so, you know, when this instruction entered the pipeline, I said, well, I won't need P3 anymore. I might need P35. But I don't put P3 back in the free pool. Okay, because if for some reason there was an exception before this point, then I would still need to refer to P3. Okay, and likewise, if this branch, say, were to be mispredicted, and I had to later go along the other correct path, maybe along that correct path, I would still need to read the value in R3, which would then refer to P3, not the value in P35. Okay, so I cannot throw away P3 until I know for sure that all previous instructions have completed successfully, and until I know that all previous branches have been predicted correctly. So it is only when this instruction over here commits that I am sure that P35 is the permanent home of that result, that everyone from this point on is going to refer to P35, and no one is going to need the result in P3. Okay, so it's only at this point that I free up that register P3. Okay. One other thing I should mention over here is that if I have 64 registers, it means I have 32 rename registers. Okay, that means I can actually track the state or I can track the temporary results of 32 different instructions, which means I can have 32 different in-flight instructions in my pipeline. Okay, so by having a reorder buffer with only six instructions, I'm actually underutilizing my large register file. Okay, in reality, I could have had a reorder buffer that had at least 32 instructions. Okay, because there are some instructions over here that don't need a register, instructions like branches and stores. Okay, so if I have a reorder buffer of, say, size 40, I'm just using an example, you know, there's a good chance that I'm using all of my 32 available rename registers. Okay, and by having a larger reorder buffer, I'm also ensuring that I have more instructions to look at, that the issue queue is more likely to find instructions to issue every single cycle, if it can look at this larger window of instructions. Okay, so in some sense, the size of the reorder buffer equals the size of the physical register file minus the size of the logical or architected register file. Okay, so in this example, if the physical register file has 64 entries and my architecture defines 32 registers, then it means that I have 32 extra rename registers that can be used by instructions in flight that have an entry in my reorder buffer. Okay, so you'll see over here that I'm no longer doing any copies of register names, right? So when I produce a result, I put it in P33, and every subsequent instruction that needs that result is going to get its value from P33. Okay, and when I commit that instruction, I no longer do a copy from P33 into some other location. I just say that P33 is now the permanent home of R1. So all I do is introduce this structure called the committed register map table, and I modify it to say that, you know, now if I want the value in R1, I can find it not in P1, but in P33. Okay, there's also this other structure that I seemingly introduced, but this is a structure that always existed. So even my previous design needed a structure to keep track of where I can find the latest value of some register. Okay, so this is not a new structure being introduced. Okay, so most processes today do something like this. They do implement a design like this where you don't have to copy register names upon commit, and you just have two separate map tables. Okay, so I should also clarify that if you look at my program, and if you assume that, you know, these are all the instructions that I execute in my program, say in sequential order, my speculative map table keeps track of everything that has happened until, you know, some point in this program, and the committed map table keeps track of everything that has happened until an earlier point in the program. Okay, and you know, these instructions in this gap over here are the ones sitting in my reorder buffer. Okay, so those are the instructions that have not yet committed, but that have been seen by the process, that is, they've entered the pipeline, and those instructions have been potentially renamed. And so that's, you know, this is also a good intuitive way to imagine what is being stored by the speculative map table and the committed map table.